Our desire was to make GA memorable for you. We wanted to show you all that Colorado has to offer. We gave you two really beautiful, nice days, and then we gave you a tornado. And so years from now, you're not going to remember probably a lot about our church, a lot about maybe what happened in this room, maybe bits and pieces. But then when somebody says, you remember that time at GA there was a tornado and we went down to the basement or in the hallway or into a bathroom and we were there for a really, really long time, you're going to say, yes, I remember Cherry Hills, and you are welcome. How many of you were supposed to fly out already, and because of being stuck in a tornado, you are still here with us? Oh, nobody. All right. That's great. This feels like the Sunday night crowd. I don't know if your church still does Sunday night church. Mine does not, praise the Lord. And the Sunday morning crowd, you have a really big crowd, and then the Sunday night crowd, it's like most people have gone home, and it's just your super Christians that have shown up. And so that is you. That is those people that are like, we are staying to the end, and I pray that God will bless you as a result of it. What Dean said to us is incredibly, incredibly gracious of him, but here's my encouragement. Don't rob Peter to pay Paul. And so if you're going to write a check first and foremost to what he presented in terms of helping EPC pastors, and then if you want to do something for us, which is not necessary, but if you want to, make that secondary, because God has got this place in his hand. And when catastrophe strikes, and praise God it wasn't worse than it was, there's always an opportunity for the gospel. And prayerfully in the coming days, this will be a moment for us in our community to love people and love people well. Let's pray together, then we'll go to God's word. Heavenly Father, as we close out this general assembly, Lord, I pray that you would speak to each and every one of us in a powerful way. God, I ask that you will send your Holy Spirit, that it will be you who speaks. Help me get out of the way. God, help us to leave tonight excited. God, help us to leave tonight more passionate. God, help us to leave tonight with a new vigor and excitement for the calling that you've placed on each and every one of us. Thank you for the EPC. Help us to be good stewards of that which you have given us. In the name of the Lord Jesus Christ we pray, amen. You reach a certain point in life and you realize that life today is different than when you were a kid. And I don't know exactly what age that happens, but it becomes really apparent when you have kids because they start to talk about things. And without even intending to, you naturally say, yeah, well, when I was a kid. And those words come out of your mouth and you thought that you would never say those words and then you did. And you're trying to explain to your kids, well, we didn't have an iPhone. And we didn't have an iPad. And we didn't have Netflix. We had things called commercials. My kids, the one that they really don't understand is when I said we did not have the internet. And they're like, psh, what? And then when you try and describe dial-up, that's a whole different thing. I pulled up that sound a year ago. We had our summer interns. So summer interns, I mean, they're around 20 years old. We have our summer interns. And I pull up the dial-up sound, the AOL, you all know it. I play that, and not a single one of the 20-year-olds had ever heard that noise before in their entire life. And I was like, what? But life changes, and it changes quickly, changes sometimes abruptly, changes drastically. Probably a great way to demonstrate that is if you just look at the history of playground equipment. Like this, when I was growing up, it's called a jungle gym. I don't know what you do with a jungle gym. I don't really know when they invented the jungle gym what they thought the purpose was, but we played King of the Hill. That's what we did with the jungle gym. And so you were trying to be this kid on the top, and if other kids came close to you, you pushed them down. And you felt it on the way down because you hit 5, 6, sometimes 10 metal bars. And back in the day, we just called that, hey, shake it off. Get back in the game. This is not built on a plate. If your church is doing a building project right now, this is not going to be one of the things that you put on your playground. I think lawyers have removed these from our country. Another one of my favorite pieces of playground equipment. Now, I don't know what you did with this particular piece of equipment, but the only way I can think of to use this is you put a few people on it, and then one volunteer, their job is to spin it as fast as they possibly can. And then the goal is to fling children off of it. And if you stayed on, you won. And if you fell off, you might have broke something. And that was good old-fashioned fun back in the day. But as fun as this was, now I grew up in Texas, down in Houston. All right, we've got some Texans in the room. Right now in Texas, it's 100 degrees. And it's the coolest it will be all summer. But in the middle of summer, you would sometimes go down one of these. And part of the joy of going down this slide in particular was that it was 250 degrees. And so you felt like you were going so fast because you felt like you were on fire. And that just played into the overall enjoyment. And when you got to the bottom, that was where the real danger happened. Because there was slowly over time, a big hole would be created. And what that hole meant was that if you didn't have long enough legs, you were hitting your face. And that was just, that was what was gonna happen. Now, it's interesting because I grew up with each and every one of these. And I think of playgrounds today and I think those were crazy. Who designed those? Those weren't safe at all. And yet I found in the catalog this right here. This was a playground piece of equipment back in the 1920s and 30s. Like, this is a playground. This is not people building a building. This is a children's playground. And I look at that and I'm just like, there's a reason that's called the greatest generation. Because if you survived that right there, I mean, what? Who designed that? You know what we need to do? We need to just keep kids entertained. And the best way to do that is to make them this close to death all the time. That's what it looks like. This is some of you in your lifetime, these existed. And they don't exist anymore. Why? Because life changes. It kind of makes you worried about what are the next playgrounds going to look like. They're going to be no fun at all. That's what I know. Because they're not going to be that fun. I can promise you that. Life changes, playgrounds change, culture changes. In our lifetime, the church has changed. The role of the church inside of our culture has changed. When I was born, we lived in what most people would call a Christian nation. If we are not now a post-Christian nation, then I would submit to you that in our lifetime, we will soon be there. What happened? How do we get there? There's probably a lot of different reasons that we can point to, but I want to point out one thing that practically happened inside of our culture that fundamentally changed the church. 200 years ago, 90%, over 90% of people in the U.S. lived in a rural area. Most people, we were an agrarian society. Most people lived on a farm. Less than 10% of the population of our country lived in an urban area. Now you flash forward to today, what has happened? That number has almost completely inverted. As of 2020, 86% of the people in the United States live in an urban area. Only 14% live in a rural area. When they look at projections, they don't expect that number to change. It's gonna continue to go more and more and more people are gonna move to urban environments. Now, how did that fundamentally change the church? A few hundred years ago, if you lived on a farm, the only people you saw were the people that lived on that farm with you, primarily your family. That's why people had lots of kids, because they needed more people to work on the farm. And so the only time during the week that you had the chance to go see anybody other than those people that you lived with was where? It was on Sunday. People went to church. They went to church not just to worship God and learn about God. They went to church because the only place that they could find community was church on Sundays. Not only that, but the other two places that people experienced that community would have been at a wedding and at a funeral. That's when towns got together. Where do those two places always happen? At the church. So just think for a moment about this. For most of our country's history, the church had a monopoly on community. You had to go to church if you wanted to have community. What has changed rapidly the last 20 years, last 10 years? Do we have a monopoly on community anymore? No. Now, I would argue that if you're talking about gospel community, we still have something. Obviously, we only have the gospel. We have a monopoly on that. But even something deeper, discipleship, real genuine community, there's something distinct and different there. But there's a lot of ways to have false community. That slowly, in the last 100 years, what has grown exponentially is our houses. Your house size is twice as big as what the average house size was 50 years ago. We've grown bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger houses. Inside those houses, we have more and more and more and more forms of entertainment than we've ever had before. Now, if you build a giant house and you have endless amounts of entertainment, the temptation is to not leave the house. In addition to that, you have community everywhere. You have community on social media. You have community at your neighborhood pool. You have community at your kids' school, your kids' sporting teams. You have community on an app. You have community in so many different ways. But something exciting happened. I'm going to say a word that I know, as fellow people that work inside the church, this was a curse word for a little bit. But COVID was really hard. And yet, COVID creates the best opportunity that I feel like we have for the sake of the gospel inside my lifetime. Here's why. What community happened during COVID, what COVID did community, was anything that was a false community, it just died. So if your community revolved around your kid's sporting team, you didn't see them at all during COVID. They weren't calling to check in on you. They weren't calling to see how you were doing. If your community was at work or in all these other things, it just stopped. If you look at every study on human happiness, they come up with two different things about the United States right now. We live in the most affluent moment to live in the history of mankind. When it comes to luxuries, the average person in our country has never had more luxuries than what we have right now. You compare us to any other moment in human history. You compare us to kings or queens in human history. We have far more luxury. So we have more stuff than we've ever had. And yet every study, especially after COVID, would tell you that people are more miserable today than they ever have been in the history of those studies. There's a thing that's called a happiness index, where they measure people's happiness. And as life has continually gotten better and better and better, in the United States of America, the happiness index has gotten lower and lower and lower. And right now is an all-time low. Coming out of COVID, every negative measurable is at an all-time high. Suicide rates are up. Depression is up. Domestic abuse was up. But we live in a land that from a worldview standpoint, when they look at their life, they look at their satisfaction, they look at their community, there is famine. And what better moment for you and I, for the capital C Church, for our denomination, to proclaim the good news of Jesus? It shouldn't be a surprise that as our church, our culture has gotten less churched and less Christian, they've become more and more miserable. And maybe this is the time that God has been sowing those seeds in people's hearts for something amazing and great to happen. If you've got a Bible, turn with me to Ephesians chapter 4. We're going to look at our theme verse for the GA this year. 4:12 is what we'll end up with. We're going to start in verse 1. This whole thing this week is about sharpening one another. How can we, as the body of Christ, as fellow workers, sharpen one another, call each other out, encourage one another to do great things for our Lord and Savior Jesus? Ephesians chapter 4. We're going to look at the first three verses and then we'll skip down. It says this: I therefore, a prisoner for the Lord, urge you to walk in a manner worthy of the calling to which you've been called, with all humility and gentleness, with patience, bearing with one another, in love, eager to maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Then go ahead and skip down, starting in verse 11. He says, and he gave the apostles, he's talking about the gifts that God gives us. It says, he gave the apostles, the prophets, the evangelists, the shepherds, the teachers. He's just wrapping us all up in this giant bundle. He says, the gifts that God has given you inside the church, the gifts that God has given me inside the church, the reason he has given us those gifts is to equip the saints for the work of ministry, for building up the body of Christ. Now pause for a second, we'll continue to read, but just let that verse resonate with us for a second. That the giftedness that God has given me is not for my glory, it's not for my benefit. It's not for your glory, it's not for your benefit. It is in order to be used for God's glory, to equip the body of Christ, but not just for their benefit. That we are equipping the body of Christ so that they can also do the work of ministry, in order to build up the body of Christ. I'm a church guy. I love parachurch ministry. I think there's some wonderful parachurch ministries. Yet, there's only one organization that exists on this planet today that is going to be an eternal organization. Every other organization that you are a part of will cease to exist. Some of them will cease to exist in your lifetime. But the church, the capital C church, will be forever. And the calling that we have is to pour into the bride of Christ, to equip the bride of Christ so that our churches can become multiplication churches, that we're pouring into people in order that they might also build up the body of Christ. We continue to do that until we all attain to the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God, to mature manhood, to the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ, so that we may no longer be children tossed to and fro by the waves and carried about by every wind of doctrine, by human cunning, by craftiness and deceitful scheme. It's this idea that we need to be raising up spiritual men and women, not just spiritual infants, inside of our congregations. I think one of the big challenges when you look at the capital C church across our country is that we have a lot of people who attend church, but they aren't the church. That's a big difference between those two things. That I can attend, church can be a location, it can be a place I visit, or it can be an identity that I am the church. That we need to be raising up people instead of just spiritual infants. We need mature believers that are pouring into one another that creates other mature believers. Yet Paul also gives this warning at the end. He says you've got to be careful to come against the cunning schemes of the world, of man, of Satan. I think in the midst of COVID, Satan was probably excited. Probably there's a piece of that that he's thinking, I've destroyed so many churches. So many churches are struggling. And yet here's what I know, that God always uses destruction for his glory and for his good. And as much as we might look back at COVID and say, let me never deal with that again, because I know your congregation probably didn't have this, but the congregations I was inside of, it was a little tense during that season. It didn't matter what decision you made. People didn't like it during that season. And probably all of us got to the end of that and said, whew, I don't ever want to do that again. And yet, can I just tell you, I personally believe that God has used COVID to demonstrate inside of people's lives their own brokenness, their own futility, their own struggle. And what better opportunity would we ever have than right now for the gospel? But it only happens if we are equipping the people inside of our congregation to be used for God, by God, to the glory of God. One of the things I love about our denomination, when I was in the process 2 years ago, actually this summer 2 years ago, I was in the process of not just coming to Cherry Hills, but also coming to the EPC. Had some amazing, amazing men and women inside the EPC that really our church, Cherry Hills Community Church, might not be here if it weren't for our denomination and the people that came alongside us. Guys like Doug Ressler, Brad Strait, who poured into this congregation, poured into our session, and helped in a really challenging time for our congregation to persevere. And so in the midst of that, when I was having this conversation, I went to the EPC website, and I fell in love with the quote that was at the very top, which I looked today, it's not there right now. But here's the phrase that for a long time, it's a famous phrase you know. People always attribute it to Augustine. He didn't ever actually say it. There's like four other guys that people maybe say have said it. But it's a famous phrase, in the essentials unity, in non-essentials liberty, and all things charity. So let's just unpack for a second what that practically looks like inside of a church. What are some of those essential things, and what are some of those non-essential things? And the list that I have that I want to talk about tonight, it's by no way exhaustive. You could have way more things on the essentials. I'm sure you could have way more things on the non-essentials. But three things that I would say are very essential inside the church that we'll unpack in a second are the Bible, the Great Commission, and compassion. That this is our foundation. The Great Commission is our purpose given us by God. And compassion is the way about which we pursue that purpose. The attitude, the reflection, and how we demonstrate. But then there's plenty of things inside the church that are non-essential things. Style is one of them. Probably there were moments this week where you loved our music. And there were probably some moments this week that you hated our music. And there's probably some moments this week that you said, it's too dark in this room. And maybe there's some moments this week that you said, it's too loud in this room. And probably there's some moments this week that you looked over those windows and you said, they have mountains on the other side of those windows. Why don't they lift those things up? What's wrong with them? And here's why I know that some of you have those opinions. Because I hear those opinions every week. There's a person inside our congregation every single week that doesn't like something. That probably doesn't ever happen to your congregation. But inside of our congregation, that's what happens. You see, oftentimes, what can tend to happen is that we can take non-essential things inside the church, like style, and they can drift towards essential things. Personalities is another non-essential thing. That there's a temptation in the American church to make the church revolve around a personality, a celebrity pastor. And it can be successful. There's plenty of big churches in the country that they're built around that personality. And yet, that is a non-essential. The essential things are things that will forever be a part of the church. Anything that is temporary is really a non-essential. You see, here in my experience are the two easiest ways to kill a church. That if we let the essentials become non-essentials, it'll kill a church. Well, what does that look like? Take the Bible, for example. If we take theology, important, essential theology, and we allow it to become non-essential, as many churches in our culture have done, ultimately it will destroy the church. We're in a time right now with all things LGBTQ, and there's this whole cultural conversation of what do we do with it? And we've got to have conversations in that space with love and compassion, and yet, the most loving thing that we can do is to only affirm a lifestyle that lines up with the Word of God in Scripture. And so the moment that I take the Bible and say, well, that's non-essential, I'm gonna move that to that category, I might win the day temporarily, but long-term, it will ultimately destroy my church every single time. So we have to be on our guard to make sure that essentials stay essentials, that they don't become non-essentials, but we also have to be on our guard that we don't let non-essentials become essentials. How many churches have you heard of that they blow up because of really a stupid, non-essential thing? I've heard of church splits over the color of the carpet. Genuinely. Churches that got so fighting with each other, so at each other's throats, that ultimately they split the church because they couldn't agree on the color of carpet. The worship wars that in our lifetime probably will never end. What's the right style of music? I don't like that style of music. I want this style of music. And churches fight about it all the time. It's a non-essential. One of the things that I try and tell our congregation a lot is, hey, if you don't like the music, just hang on. Maybe there's gonna be another song that you do like. But can I just tell you that whatever your style is, that you love more than any other style, it's probably not the style we're gonna be using in heaven. Most likely, I don't know. But if you look at the last 2,000 years of the church, globally, internationally. You go on a mission trip, and I can promise you, the songs that they're singing in Uganda, the songs that they're singing in Mexico, the songs that they're singing in any other country in the world sound very different than ours. Has a very different style, has a very different sound. You see, the style can't be the essential thing. And when we make it essential, it destroys our church. And I would say the same thing is true for a denomination. We've got to be in a denomination that says the essentials, we're never going to let them become non-essentials. And we're not going to let non-essentials become essentials. The Great Commission has to be an essential. Here's two questions that I try and wrestle with. First, I say, is the Great Commission an essential in my life personally? And then, is the Great Commission an essential in my church? And sometimes we take the Great Commission, and I'll get asked this question, is your church an evangelism church or a discipleship church? You ever heard that question before? Maybe you've asked that question. I think it's the dumbest question I've ever heard. Now, I'm always patient with my response and encourage you with my response, but nowhere in Scripture do they divide evangelism from discipleship and turn them into two completely different things. That evangelism and discipleship are two sides of the same coin. That if you are growing up mature disciples, they will lead to evangelism. And if we are evangelizing well, it includes discipleship. They are the same thing. You can't cut them in half. They have to be packaged together. To encourage us in the Great Commission. I mean, look back at the early church. It should get us excited when we look through Acts and we see over and over and over again, we see them fulfilling the Great Commission that Jesus had given them. In Acts 2:41, so those who received his word were baptized, and there were added that day about 3,000 souls. 47, praising God and having favor with all the people, and the Lord added to their number day by day, those who were being saved. 4:4, but many of those who had heard the word believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. 4:20, for we cannot, this is the disciples speaking, they say, for we cannot but speak of what we have seen and heard. They were being told, hey, stop it. We're gonna beat you up. Stop proclaiming the gospel. And they said, no, we cannot but speak. 6:1 says, now in these days, when the disciples were increasing in number, 6:7, and the word of God continued to increase, and the number of the disciples multiplied greatly in Jerusalem. 8:4, those who had been scattered preached the word wherever they went. Now, this is an interesting verse when it comes to our theme verse in Ephesians, because who stayed in Jerusalem? The disciples. And so who is this that's been scattered that are preaching the word? It's the people that the disciples have been discipling. It's the people inside the church. You see, our job isn't just to preach the word of God. It's to raise up people in our congregations that also preach the word of God. But if the Great Commission is going to be an essential in our congregations, it first and foremost has to be an essential in my heart and in your heart. Lee Strobel, who wrote a lot of different books, it's the real deal. Three months out of the year, he's in Colorado, and when he's here, he attends our church. And if you go to lunch with Lee, Lee is evangelizing all the time. He's constantly sharing the gospel with people. And if you hear Lee talk enough, one of the things he likes to pose to the congregation, to the audience, is this question right here. He says, if God answered every prayer you've prayed for the past 2 weeks, how many new believers would there be as a result of those prayers? And man, the first time I heard him say that, it felt like a kick in the gut. Because I thought back in the last 2 weeks of my life and I said, am I on my knees praying for those that don't know Jesus, that God, through the power of his Holy Spirit, would make a way for them to know Jesus? Think for a moment. Who's on your list that you're praying for every single day that God would do a great work in their life? If we want churches that are passionate about the Great Commission and evangelism, it starts with us being passionate about the Great Commission and evangelism. There's a video that went viral a couple years ago. There's a video that is kind of an appalling video when you take a step back and think about it. But it's a video of a guy who is in New York. He's walking alongside a subway, and there's a lot of rain outside, which is very relative to what happened to us today. As a result of that rain, a wall that is in the subway starts to get pushed away. So I want to show you the video. So this is a guy that this wall just all of a sudden bursts. So this water starts pushing him towards a subway train. And there's a guy that is standing, what, 10 feet away from him. And if you look at the video a couple more times, you actually see that there's some other people standing next to this person. And instead of jumping out and helping this person, what does he do? He pulls out his cell phone and he makes a video of it. A video that he then puts onto social media. So instead of saving this guy's life, he uses it as an opportunity to advance himself. Happens in our culture all the time. There's a thing that they call the bystander effect. The bystander effect is this idea and concept that the presence of other people discourages an individual from intervening in an emergency situation. That's why if you ever go through CPR training, the first thing they tell you to do in CPR training, before you start doing compressions, is that you're supposed to point to somebody, one person, and say, you call 911. They say, never just say, someone call 911. Because if you say in a crowd, someone call 911, everybody assumes that somebody else is gonna do it. And so they don't end up doing anything. And can I tell you that sometimes in our churches, we can fall into that same thing. We can have this idea that, well, God didn't give me the gift of evangelism. Hey, somebody else is gonna share the gospel with that person. Hey, we're not an evangelism church. We're trying to fulfill the Great Commission in other ways, but God doesn't give us that as an option. We see the New Testament church and it's exploding. Why? Obviously, it's through the power of the Holy Spirit, but they're passionate about the Great Commission that God has given them. It was an essential in the church. There's this famous quote from Penn Jillette. He's half of the magician duo Penn and Teller. He's the one that talks. And he's an atheist, an avid atheist. Even more than that, I'd say he's an anti-theist. It's not just that he doesn't believe in God. He dislikes people who believe in God. And yet, he posted this video one time, which is a very somber video. It's just him staring into the camera. And this is what he said. He said, I've always said that I don't respect people who don't proselytize. I don't respect that at all. If you believe that there's a heaven and a hell, and people could be going to hell or not getting eternal life, and you think that it's not really worth telling them because it would make it socially awkward, and atheists who think people shouldn't proselytize and who say, just leave me alone and keep your religion to yourself, how much do you have to hate somebody to not proselytize? How much do you have to hate somebody to believe everlasting life is possible and not tell them about it? I mean, if I believed beyond the shadow of a doubt that a truck was coming at you and you didn't believe that truck was bearing down on you, there is a certain point where I tackle you. And this is more important than that. It's an atheist that says if you really understood it, then nothing could stop you from pursuing that purpose. For us, for our churches, the Great Commission has to be essential. But how we go about the Great Commission has to be fueled with compassion. Compassion is an interesting word because in English, it's a noun. It comes from the Latin word compati, which means to suffer with. So this idea of compassion is that, oh, you're going through a hard time and I'm gonna relate to you. But in the Greek, compassion is actually a verb. It's probably my favorite word in the Greek. It's splagnitsomai. It's this really kind of coarse, ugly word. And it means gut or stomach. And it's a verb that means a feeling inside of one's gut. In the Greek, it represents your stomach. But it's a verb. And so anytime that we see this verb compassion in the Greek, it's not just someone feeling something, it's something that is driving them to action. In the New Testament, that word splagnitsomai is there 12 times. 8 of those times, it's either being used by Jesus or it's describing Jesus. Jesus, when he tells the parable of the Good Samaritan, he says the Good Samaritan sees the man on the side of the road who's been beat up. It says he has compassion, splagnitsomai, that he's moved to action because he relates and resonates with them. Multiple times, Jesus heals someone. And the reason he heals that person is because he had splagnitsomai. He had compassion. He felt their pain, and that pain moved him to action. How do we, inside the church, grow and compassion? It's a simple thing. It starts by name and by need. It's an expression we use with our staff, our volunteers a lot. That we want to be a church that knows people, the people that come in our congregation by name and by need. And that's hard. It's hard to know someone by name because we have a lot of people that come through our church. But you and I know the difference between someone that you see that knows you by name and someone that you see that clearly has forgotten your name. Probably this week you've had some of those experiences. Maybe you've been on the good side or the bad side and you saw someone and you said, I should know their name, but I don't. So I'm gonna say, hey, you, buddy, my man, my partner, good to see you. And somewhere in that conversation you say, they don't remember who I am. And have you ever met someone where you met them just briefly and then the next time you see them, they use your name? There's something powerful about that. You say, wow, they know my name. We need to be congregations that get to know our people by name. But one step further than that is knowing people by need. I know a lot of people's names. But if you said, what's the biggest need in their life? I'd say, I don't know. Because to know the biggest need in someone's life, it takes effort. It takes intentionality. I have to have a conversation. I have to care. When that happens, it changes the dynamic of the relationship. I started out as a children's pastor before I became a youth pastor and a campus pastor and a senior pastor. When I was a children's pastor, we had these two kids, brother and sister, named Joshua and Cameron. They showed up one day and they were brand new kids and they were those kids inside the children's ministry that were really challenging kids. And month goes by and all of a sudden, every single week, I was getting called into their classrooms. Two different classrooms. They weren't together. One was older, one was younger. And to call in the children's pastor is like waving the white flag. It's like the walk of shame to say, hey, I need you to come deal with this kid. And so every week, for a few months, I kept dealing with Joshua and Cameron. Every single week. Get to that point where I'm not a very good person, so in the back of my mind, I'm thinking, maybe if they didn't show up this week, it would be better for everybody. You know, the other kids in the room, they would have a better experience. They would hear the gospel, these two troublemakers. And then my relationship with Joshua and Cameron radically changed, and it had nothing to do with them. You see, I learned the story of Joshua and Cameron. That Joshua and Cameron, in the year before I met them, their father had committed suicide. Their mother had run away. They had an aunt that was murdered in gang violence. They had an uncle who was high on drugs that got hit by a train. Grandma and grandpa take them into their home. Grandma and grandpa don't speak a lick of English. They knew that these kids had been through a lot, and so they started showing up to church with them. And when I heard that, it crushed me. It changed that relationship. Because before, I was dreading them showing up because I knew that I was gonna go have to have a conversation. I knew that conversation wasn't gonna change anything. But once I knew their story, my heart broke for them. And all of a sudden, every single Sunday, you know what two kids I wanted to see more than anybody else? Joshua and Cameron. And I made it a point every single week to go find Joshua, go find Cameron, to get down on my knees, to look them in the eyes. And I said, I love you, and I'm so glad that you're here. And I want you to know that Jesus loves you, because I knew that there weren't very many people in their life that were telling them that. It changed my relationship drastically. And God did an amazing work in their life. They grew up in our church. They grew up in our youth ministry. They became great young men and young women for Jesus. And it wasn't because of me. It was because of him. What if we became churches that lived out in the Great Commission, but we did it with compassion? Where we cared about the people that were walking in our doors. No matter what sin they were dealing with, no matter what struggle they had, I'll end with a verse in 2 Corinthians chapter 3, verses 2 through 5. It says this, you are our letter, written in our hearts, known and read by all people, revealing yourselves that you are a letter of Christ, delivered by us, written not with ink, but with the Spirit of the living God, not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of human hearts. Such is the confidence we have toward God through Christ. Not that we are adequate in ourselves as to consider anything as having come from ourselves, but our adequacy is from God. We're a love letter to the world every day with how we live. I wanna end in a little bit different of a way. I would encourage you, if you are physically able, to stand up and then take a knee. So it's a little bit of a different way to end our time together. But if you can, if you can't, don't worry about it. There's zero pressure. But if you physically can, would you move to an aisle or move to right where you are and just take a knee? And here's what I'd like to do as we close in prayer is I want to pray that each one of us as we go out can have those people on our heart, those people that we have relationship with that don't know God, that we would make the Bible an essential in our churches, we would make the Great Commission an essential in our churches, and we would make having compassion an essential. And so I just want you to take 1 minute, and I want you to, by name, cry out to God for some people in your life that do not know him. Cry out to God for you personally, for our churches collectively in our denomination, for your church personally, that we might have a heart for the lost, that would be an essential to all of us. So just take a minute. Spend a moment in prayer, and then I'll close this out. We know, just as Paul writes in that verse, that we are not adequate in and of ourselves. God, that if we make it about us or our ability or what we can do, we accomplish nothing. God, we thank you that it's never been about us. It's always been about you. God, so help us to be your love letter to the world around us. Help our churches to be your love letter to the world around us. Help our denomination to be your love letter to the world around us. God, despite our inadequacies, we know that you are worthy. You are adequate. Through the power of your Holy Spirit, we can never change a life, but you can. And so, God, we pray that we can have a passion those people in our communities, those people in our own personal lives that don't know you, that with that compassion, it will be a verb that spurs us on to action, to love them well and pray for them that they might come to the saving knowledge and understanding of you. God, I pray that we will be excited as we leave this General Assembly, as we close our time together, that we can walk away lifting high your name, change from the inside out forever because of who you are. Lift up all these things in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen.